So welcome to another edition of On the Sidelines. I'm really happy to say I'm joined by ex-Cambridge United midfielder, skipper, even took charge of the team a few times, Paul Carden. How you doing there, Cardi?
I'm good, mate. I'm good. I'm all good. It's Friday. The house is empty. I've got a fridge full of Budweiser. And yeah, it's good.
And no game tomorrow.
No, see, I'm not too... I'm missing the football now. The novelty has worn off with this stuff, this lockdown stuff. You know, I know it's easing and all that, but until the football comes back properly, as I say, the novelty's worn off. We know.
Yeah, sure. So you're manager of Warrington Town FC. That's right. I believe you've been manager for about 4 years. Is that right, Cardi?
Yeah, I've been there a while now. Yeah, when I left Tranmere. I took over, yeah. It's been 4 years, but we've done all right. Like we've done quite well.
Must be a bit frustrating. I had a look at the table earlier today. Am I right in saying you were sat in third, and obviously you'd done a lot of work and accumulated however many points, and for the season to obviously abruptly end, you know, it was an unforeseen thing that happened. But you know, it must be a little bit hard to take. There's no other option, obviously, to scrap the season, but.
No, ours was, our league was null and voided. I think it was one of the first ones to be null and voided. And we were third, and we finished third last season and the season before. So it's been frustrating. Last season, obviously not the season that just finished, the season before, we won our league playoff. We won our league playoff final against South Shields away, who were, if you don't know, they're a really big club. They're destined to keep going. And we beat them at their place. And Farsley won the league. South Shields was second, then it was us. So we beat them, but in a one-off only. Never happened before, never happened again. There was a super playoff final. Right. And we played Kings Lynn at home because we had a better points per game ratio. And just some bizarre concoction of the way the FA had structured it. Kings Lynn beat us in the last minute of extra time, 3-2. And so that was a tough one to take because in any other year, in any other division, the league playoff winners get promotion. And we didn't. So we had to pick ourselves up and go again. And it was a bit of a slow start last season. And even though we were third, we weren't what we were the previous season, but we were still competitive and strong. We'd lost the fewest amount of games, which was always, you know, we were always known to be a tough team to beat. The previous season was the same. We had the best defensive record, most clean sheets the previous season, when we got beat by Kings Lynn that season. So we've always been a tough side to beat. But unprecedented times and the way things go, and you know that was out of our control, so nothing we can do, just plan and prepare to go again for next season.
That's right, of course. Seems like a good community feel around the club, Warrington. I had a look earlier in the press and I see they'd set up a GoFundMe page and they'd raised, like, I sort of, my eyes popped out. It was like they'd exceeded what the target was. So it must be good that you've got a good community fan base there and everyone's pulled together to help the club keep going forward in these horrible times.
Well, it is, and it's a credit to everybody. The chairman's brilliant. He's brilliant. And when I left Southport, I vowed that if I was going to go back into being a manager, you know, whatever level, I didn't want to go into a club that would only give us the opportunity to be second favourites. And you know, no disrespect to Southport, but at the time we were a full-time club paying part-time wages, and we were putting fires out every week. And when the opportunity for Warrington came after I'd left Tranmere, which, you know, people were looking and going, why has he gone there? Why has he gone? You know, it was about the chairman and his ambition and, you know, how he wanted to move things forward. And we've become really good friends. And we speak 3-4 times a day. about numerous things, not just football. And I think the GoFundMe thing was, you know, he was reluctant to do that because that's the type of fella he is. He wants to be the one who gets things. And it was me pushing him to do it. And it, as I say, he didn't want to give the nod on it, but he did eventually. And yet, the you know, surpassing the target wasn't a surprise. But Warrington's a big town, but it's a big rugby town. And so, you know, how the chairman describes us is we're like the noisy neighbours in the little house down the road. The rugby don't want anything to do with us. They have a training ground that's empty for half of the football season with an indoor dome in winter, 3G in it. But we don't. They won't have anything to do with us to let us use that. You know, I don't know whether they're scared of us sort of going on and getting promotion and going full time, and then a little bit like Wigan did, Wigan Athletic. You know what I mean? They've basically, as a Premier League club, overtook the rugby.
In that
sense, or at least it's an even sort of supported place now. So whether they're wary of that happening, I don't know. But you know, I believe that as a town, whatever sport is in that town, they should work together to promote the town and promote every sport, and not just have one above the other. They should, you know, back each other. But you know, maybe I am going to say that as the smaller sporting club, but I don't think I'd be at a club who didn't want to help others as well. Because you know, it's good for everyone if the clubs in the town are doing well. But it was the chairman who got me, and the opportunity to build something was big for me.
Right, yeah, fantastic. So you've got good things going on there, so it's pleasing that you're doing well. You've got a few ex-Cambridge United links there, Cardi. Is Mark Beasley the assistant with you? Is that right?
He is, yeah. Bees has been with me from day one. Bees was managing his hometown club, Bersko, who were in the league below Warrington. And he just had knowledge of the levels. And he, you know, he's a bit of a geek, Bees. He looks like a geek. So so he's, you know, no, he's good. He's good. He's organised, and he's, you know, he's thorough with what he does. And he came in with me straight away, and yeah, you know, we bounce off each other. We've known each other a long time since we were early 20s at Chester. So we're friends, but you know, I trust him, and he knows how I work. So
it works.
Yeah.
What about Robbo? Mark Roberts, is he up there with you?
Yeah, Robbo's skipper. I brought Robbo in not the summer gone, the summer before, and he's been immense. Immense. His first season, he was in team of the year, but that didn't shock me. Him and Dave Raven, me two centre halves, they were team of the year centre halves.
Proper, you know, professional, Robbo, isn't he?
He's an educated lad. He does things right. He's not a baller. In terms of, he doesn't scream and shout, and he sets examples in other ways because of how he conducts himself, how he carries himself, how dedicated he is, and you know, he's done great for us. I'm pleased to say he's agreed to stay next season as well. So even at his age, 35, he's not changed from when he was 25. He couldn't move. But he could block, and he could head, and he could organise, and he didn't have to shout across the pitch. He just pulled people in around him. So when you're not the most mobile or quick, you have to organise, and that's what he does. What he does well, and it allows him to play to his strengths. But he also encourages others to do that as well. So you know, he's very good for us.
Of course, yeah. Great stuff. So wish you all the best going forward with Warrington anyway, Cardi.
We'll just
touch on your playing career. Obviously, you were extremely successful at Chester and had some of your great playing days there. Burton Albion, I know you had a good season there, and you spoke very highly of Nigel Clough. Obviously, he's a famous name in the game. Just talk to us a little bit about Nigel and how he helped you develop and what makes him a good manager, if you like.
Well, you know, in a few interviews, you get asked the question, you know, which managers stand out. And, you know, you'd have to learn off people who you think were good, but also who you didn't think were very good either. You know, and Cloughy he wasn't a coach. He wasn't somebody who would put, you know, technical drills on or sessions. It was just very basic. Keep ball, play at a tempo, you know, finishing, small-sided games. There was nothing complicated about it. You know, he was one of them who believed that you need good players, which is true, and you need them to play with tempo and commitment and aggression, and you know, which is true again. But he didn't complicate it. But one of the best things about him was that he'd speak to you, and he wouldn't want the conversation to look like a manager-player conversation. He'd want it to be the same level, you know, like me and you are now.
Yeah.
He'd want that communication because he'd want to find out the person behind the player.
Right.
And I had a conversation with him, and he did that. And it's pretty obvious why he did it, but he didn't want that. He didn't want to lose the authoritativeness of being a manager, but he wanted to understand the player more, or the person more behind the player. And he'd just have conversations with you, and it might only be 3-4 minutes. But it was enough to show that he wanted to know more about you, your background, and blah, 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 your family. And he was very conscious of things like that. And it's something I massively took on board. Small details like, and it might sound insignificant, but normally in other clubs and other places, and even in other jobs that you go to, you have to go to them.
Yes.
You know, as a player, I've had to go to clubs to speak to them. And he came and met me halfway. So where I am in Liverpool to Burton is probably 90-odd miles. Now, he came up the M6 to meet me halfway. Yeah. Now, he didn't have to do that because I would have been prepared to go there because that's the normal.
Yes.
But he met me. And something I've always done is go to a player because it shows I want to speak to that player as much as they want to speak to me.
Yeah.
You know, because a player will always drive to a club if they want to go to the club. And sometimes if you don't show that level of commitment, that same level of commitment that you want to sign the player as they want to be there, then, you know, I just think it's a what's the way of putting it? It's a joint effort, you know, to make a move happen or not happen. And he just rubbed off on me a lot. And I wasn't there that long. I left Peterborough in the October, and I think I signed till the end of the season. And but in that time, he was quality fella. Quality, well, you know, he had good players, but as a fella, he was a top fella.
Yeah, sometimes that works, Cardi. You know, like you say, it's great man management. I know some of the players, the ex-players I've spoke to recently, played for Cambridge United under the likes of Roy McFarland. They loved him. They loved him as a gentleman and as a bloke. They had respect for him. It wasn't always the where we put this cone or that drill or, you know, like you said, flashy technical stuff, but it was just getting the right players, having that right camaraderie and getting people to play for you and having that bond and trust. So sounds like Cloughy was similar sort of mould to Roy.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, there's others as well. You know, Graham Barrow was very good. You know, at Rochdale and Chester, he's another top fella who we keep in touch with. You know, there's been people, you know, throughout my career. Early on, Gary Megson was very good to me. He gave me my debut very young when I was 17. Live on Sky against Preston for Blackpool, you know, in League One. And
what a game.
Yeah, big game. And so there's been managers who have always You'd always try and take something from everybody, yes, good or bad. And but you'd have to sort of mould it to how you want to be as a manager yourself, and use the things you've learned to be as good as you can be.
Of course, yeah, of course. So you mentioned that that P word there, Peterborough. Don't normally like talking about them. You'll probably guess what.
I know.
We haven't clashed and paths haven't crossed many times, apart from that silly little cup that they do. I'm hoping we'll catch them up again soon. But obviously, you did have a spell there. It was in a bit of a infamous period with a Big Ron documentary. I'm sure you've had to speak about that a few times. I remember it. What a volatile changing room, Cardi. What was that like at that time?
Do you know what? I think it's about a 30-second clip. And it's me, isn't it? It's me. Scrapping with Arbs, with Mark Arbour.
Yeah.
And we'd just been beat by Oxford, who got relegated. And we were supposed to be going for the playoffs. I think they beat us 3-0. And we were awful. I think Arbs had been caught for a couple of goals, trying to play out and overplay. And I've had a pop at him, and he's had a pop at me in the game. And I've come in after the game, and I'm raging. Absolutely fuming because of how we've played, how I've played, how everyone's played. Not pointing fingers or anything. I'm just boiling.
Yeah.
And he's come in and he's like rubbed me head, and he's done it just to say, listen, whatever, get on, let's just forget about it. And that just tipped me over the edge. And and I've just called him for everything. He's come back at me and blah, blah, blah. And I've gone for him and he's come for me. But it probably happened out of however many fixtures there was that day. It probably happened in half of them, something and not, there was nothing in it. It was just a few missed swings, a few shite footballers' punches that never landed.
you've seen a few of them.
Yeah, definitely. So, we spoke that night. I drove home and we spoke that night on the phone, and it was... When it's in a documentary or a fly on the wall thing, that's got to look good and generate viewers and things. Yeah. It's dramatized, isn't it? But it was embarrassing. It was embarrassing when I seen it, but I was like, oh my God.
Yeah,
but,
yeah.
As I say, it helped the club in a big way because obviously Darren McAnthony seen it, and then that was where his involvement came from, watching
it. Is that right?
Yeah, he watched it, and I think at the time it pulled in about a couple of hundred grand for the club, and I know Baz was, crying poverty, as Baz does, so that paid a few bills for the documentary, and then ultimately it got a new owner who's threw in the right few quid at them, so it was, it was embarrassing for the lads at the time. I don't think Bleo covered himself in too much glory with the way he left, right or wrong, it got the club a new owner who's backed them massively, and they've been yo-yoing between Championship and League One for some time, and I think that's what they are, where they are, to be honest. The top end League One, if you're lucky getting the Championship, I think that's where they are right now. And I had a good time there, and I know that people won't like, especially Cambridge fans won't like to hear that too much, but that was part of my career before Cambridge, and it was a good club, but it was just messy at the time. It was just a bit all over the place, to be honest. But we had a good side, and we should have done better than what we did.
Yeah, fair enough. Well, cheers for that. And like I said, I think it was good from a football fan's perspective to have a look on and see what happens in changing rooms. Like you say, it's a regular thing on the training ground, and match days is just people wanting to win, like yourself. But we'll move on from the posh and... we'll go to the best team in Cambridgeshire, which is Cambridge United. Now, if I'm right in thinking, Cardi, I was at Burton Albion on a Tuesday night, and you were sort of like a late name on the team sheet. I'm sure that's when you made your debut. And we thought,
it was, yeah.
Paul Carden, you know, we haven't heard of him, you know, no news about him signing. And you come in, played really well, steady. And that was the start of your Cambridge United journey, which had many ups and downs, it's fair to say. You saw some really strange, funny, bad low times, but also some memories you made. You know, we'll touch on them, like Stevenage at home. Obviously, it didn't end how we wanted it to end. But yeah, just talk to us about Cambridge. How would you sum your time up there?
I loved my time. I did, and I'm not saying it because I'm speaking to you, and it's gonna, you know, be seen by a few Cambridge fans. I did. I signed on loan, like you say. My first game was signed on loan from Aki, from Accrington. And my first, Alan Lewis had phoned me and said, look, we want to take you on loan. And I'd actually contacted Cluffy to see, did he want me on loan? Because I'd left Burton to go to Aki. And it was a bit of a no-brainer, really, because I was getting more money. I was closer to home. I was back in the league. And I was at a club that had tried to sign me two or three times, or a manager that had tried to sign me two or three times at that club. So it was like, there wasn't, the only big reason not to go there was leaving Burton and Cluffy. But there was too many boxes ticked to go. I only played four games. I signed a two-year deal. Started four games, and I couldn't be arsed sitting around picking up money to just be in and about it, because I was better than what that was, without sounding daft. I was.
Yeah.
And then Cambridge, obviously Lewis phoned me, Alan Lewis, and Jimmy Quinn was in charge, and I'd liked playing at Cambridge. I'd only played there a couple of times before, and I'd liked playing there. I remember the pitch. I remember always thinking the pitch was good, and it was. And anyway, so I said, yeah, no, you know, Coley pulled me, and he said, I think Grimsby were in for me, Cheltenham. There's a few clubs, and I was like, you know what, I'll give Cambridge, you know, I'll go with Cambridge. You just got a good feeling about it.
Yeah.
And I came on loan, and we done really well. And we, you know, we got beat by Exeter. We were shite. We got it wrong.
The final, you know, Coley.
Yeah, we got it wrong. We played, in my opinion, you know, you're going into a game and you see, you know, you can pick a team and you go, oh yeah, fancy us today. I actually was, you know, we worked on a bit of shape, and I was thinking, you know, the tactic was to play counter and drop off, but we had no pace. We played wing backs, and I'm thinking we had Gleese one side, I think we had Pitty left wing back. There was me, Brownie, and Rob Ulliston in midfield, and there was Lee Boylan and Lee McEvely up front, who weren't
ice
runners.
Ice.
They weren't runners.
No.
And then we had three lads at the back who were good centre halves, you know what I mean? But we were trying to hit a team on the break. We didn't have pace. I was a holding midfielder. Brownie was a holding midfielder. Rob Ulliston was a more creative midfielder, but he wasn't like a 10 who'd run beyond, or he just wanted to be on the ball and make things happen. And then you've got Gleese, who's a right back, Pitty, who's a winger, and Pitty was probably our quickest player, but he was playing wing back. He wasn't like playing out like out up on the front three, the way you see Liverpool play and that type of thing. He was playing wing back, so he was deep.
Yeah.
And we sat off and gave a team who were a possession-based side the ball on the biggest pitch around. And I don't know. I remember saying to my dad going into the game, I'm not negative. I'm never a negative person. I'll never knock back whoever I'm playing for to beat whoever we're playing against.
Yeah.
But I just didn't think we got it right. And, you know, whatever, Quinny's been, you know, he's got promotion from the conference, so who am I to question that, you know what I mean? But, you know, we didn't turn up. We weren't there. You know, and the same thing happened the following year.
Yeah, strange. I mean, obviously, same occasion, different team from the West Country. I personally thought we're going into this game in better form, a bit more exciting, great football under Gary Brabin. And you thought, well, we've been beat one time. This is our turn now.
Yeah.
And again, do you think we were just a victim of timing? You know, Torquay were a good side, to give them credit, with the likes of Hargreaves and Tim Seals, and but again, we just didn't show what we had in our locker, really, which must, I can see it still sort of aggrieves you now a little bit, you know, looking back. You had a great time at Cambridge, but that team, either one of them, should have got promoted, you know. We went up in 2014, in more recent years. You know, that was a more workmanlike side. But looking back to your time, we had flashy players like Williston, Pitt, Boylan, and we barely mustered a shot in the two games.
Yeah, well, I think the game where sort of the first game I was a player, that was my job. But the second game really hurt me because I was part of the management. I was player assistant then under Brabs. And so you feel more towards it because you've had more input in it. And obviously, when we'd been beat by Stevenage in the first leg, everyone had wrote us off, you know, and it was actually good, because there was a few interviews that went out by the Stevenage players saying it'd be nice to get promotion, it'll be nice to go to Wembley twice, because they were in the trophy final, and I remember Steve Morrison had said about, listen, he's gone on to have a fantastic career, so whatever was said in that game didn't affect him.
Yes.
As such in his career, but it affected him in the game. And I remember he said about it'd be nice signing off with a promotion and a trophy. And Phil Bolland gripped him in the tunnel. And can I swear on this?
Go ahead.
So he said, going to Wembley twice, are you? He said, we'll fucking see about that. He said, and getting a move. He said, no one's going to fucking sign you with your leg in two, are they? And he went through after about 10 minutes, Morrison. And you could see, like, Bolly didn't say a lot. But when he said things, he had this, his eyes would go closer together and he looked like he was, you know, going to switch on someone. But there was a determination in our side that day that we were going to win. And that was like Bolly in the tunnel. I remember turning around and seeing him say it, and I remember looking at Steve Morrison, and he'd gone, you know what I mean? He'd gone. He was like, you what? He didn't know what to say. He didn't front it. He didn't come back with anything. But it was actually quite funny. I remember like chuckling to myself, thinking, "Is right." And then he went through, and he went through early on after about 7-8 minutes, and he screwed the shot wide, and I thought, he's got him. He's in his head. And he was shocking. He was awful. He was awful that game. And
he was,
you know, like I say, he's had an unbelievable career. I was watching last night and I'd seen him score goals for Norwich in the Prem. And like I say, so fair play to him for that, because he was a good player. But that game, there was only ever going to be one winner. And there was only ever going to be one winner that went to Wembley, and it was us. But it, like you say, it was just such a pity.
It was
like that game should have been the game to get us up.
Yes.
Yeah, and I know it wasn't, but because of what we had to do to get to the final, and we did it, it was sad, really. It was sad, but you know, that's football, and until you're there, you've got to perform, and we didn't. And I remember speaking, and I'd never gone over to them. Pity, I still speak to Pity, and he won't like me for saying this. And in all that season, I'd never gone over to Brabs to influence a change in the game. And I remember Pity was having one; he was having a beast. And I went over to Brabs and I said, "He's killing us. Get Chrissy Oldroyd on. And just put him on the left and let him run." And he didn't. I think he done it with about 20 minutes to go. And in that game, I popped my calf, And he didn't do it, and I always, like, we speak about it all the time and say, "Why didn't you ever listen to me?" He said, I thought I'd ruin him if I took him off so early at Wembley, and I was like, "You fucking ruined us."
Yeah,
you know
what
I mean. But you know, that's not me having a go at Pity at all, because I love Pity. He's a great lad, and he done great for us. It's just that moment in time, I just felt it wasn't happening, and it was the only time I'd ever gone up to him and say, "Get him off," and I did. Yeah. I ran over. There was like something down. I went, "He needs to come off. We need pace. He's not giving us it. He's losing the ball, and just get someone running at them. They're slow." And But, you know, it is what it is. We are where we are. And Cambridge have gone on to some great things after it. So, at least, you know, at least the time that we was there, you know, we provided some good moments and some good memories, albeit we never got where we wanted to. But, you know, I think the fans will say that we had a good go at it anyway.
Yeah, certainly so. Yeah, I mean, obviously must be a special game for you, the Stevenage one. Don't know if there's any other that stand out for you, Cardi, playing for the youth.
I remember playing a game against Histon at home as well. I remember playing Histon away.
I was going to bring Histon up, so I'm pleased you said that, because we had some great battles with Histon.
Yeah, well, we played them in the trophy at their place. And if you remember Histon, they were like a basketball team. They were all massive. They seemed to have centre halves all over the pitch. And Knight Percival, and they had Righty up front, and they had three big centre half. Adder, remember him?
Patrick Adder.
And who was the other one?
Mitchell King and Langston.
God, they had just giants everywhere. You looked like it was like you were in a forest, and they were just all big trees surrounding you. And it was like, whoa, these are massive here. And they played it as well, but they played it well. They were direct, you know. I think they used to send the centre halves up for goal kicks and long throws. They had a long throw from their half, and it used to go in the 6-yard box. It was just they were horrible, but they were effective with it. And they had good players as well. It's all right being direct, but you've got to have good players to play it. And he did, and he followed the instructions of Becky and anyway, we played them, and it had been lashing down, and the game shouldn't have went on. But there was a big gate, and he came up to us and he said, "Would you mind?" This is John Beck. He said, "Would you mind warming up off the pitch?" And I went, "Why?" And he went, "Because you're going to cut it up." I said, "Well, that won't matter to you." I said, "Because it's not going to bobble, or it's not going to stick when it's in the air, is it?" I said, "We need to get used to it. So now we're going to warm up on it." And he called me for everything. I just told him where to go, and you sort yourselves out, and we'll sort us out. Anyway, I think they had a man sent off, and we struggled in the game. When I say struggled, it was just a battle. We couldn't. There was no football because the way the pitch was like a swamp.
Yeah.
And we won. I think it was either 3-2 or we scored late on, or 4-3. And that was a good game. That stands out. I remember scoring against them at home. Scored a half volley from the edge of the box, and it was a great strike, and I think we won 2-1. That was late on. But we used to have some good games against Histon.
I spoke to Antonio Murray recently, and obviously it was good to get him on our side eventually, because he was a thorn in Cambridge United's side in them games.
Always nick a goal. He always nicked a goal, and he was a better footballer than people gave him credit for. And we tried to get him in, like we spoke about, it never happened, and then it did happen. But it seemed like the worst kept secret at the time, because, you know, everyone knew he was coming, but then he wasn't. But that was part of the off the field farces that were going on at the time, to be honest.
So really, to sum Cambridge up, you had highs, lows, but I think it's fair to say it's probably more highs and more enjoyable time of your career. You played plenty of games there. I think it was second most appearances after Chester. So you spent the lion's share of your footballing career, I suppose, at Cambridge. And, you know,
the big thing for me, we moved. As I say, I was supposed to sign for Wrexham. And when the opportunity came for me to join Cambridge as player assistant I signed for Cambridge, and I turned down Wrexham, and I was getting more money off Wrexham. My missus thought we were going, and then I came home and said, "Look, we're going to have to move." She was like, "What?" And we had a little boy. He's only a few months old, our Will. And I said, "Yeah, we're going to have to move." She's like, "What do you mean? Wrexham's not that far." I was like, "No, we're going to Cambridge." She's like, "What? When's all this happened? Was you going to speak to me?" And I was like, "Well, I've made my decision. We're going to go down there and play. I'm going to be player assistant." And we moved down there. So it was just the three of us. But we had a great time. Like, we had just the three of us. And the little fella was obviously only a few months old. And that, that, that stands out to me as well, you know, that time of our, not just my football career, but my life as well. You know, we had a good time living there as well, and we as a family made memories away, not just the football. It's always you know, we always speak of our time there, living there as well as the football, you know. So it was it was good
times. Great stuff. Cheers for that, Cardi, and some interesting stories there. I like the one about Bolland, and yes, you know, it's great. You're a great servant to Cambridge. I'm glad you enjoyed playing for us anyway. Just going to mention a couple of players, if you'd say a few words about them. Scott Rendell, I'm going to say first. He was a really good player for Cambridge. I wanted him back.
Yeah.
A few times, actually, after he'd gone. How would you sum up Scotty and his time at Cambridge?
He's a proper goal scorer. You know, people used to look at him and think he was a target man or he was a hold-up player, but he was a proper goal scorer. And once he got better at gathering the ball in, setting it wide, he scored more goals, because that was probably the part of his game he needed to develop to score more goals, because he always knew where he needed to be to score goals. He scored some little glancing headers. He scored toe pokes running across defenders in the near post. You know, he scored good finishes, composed finishes. He could score all types of goals in the box, you know. And he went, after my season on loan, he went to Peterborough. And then we had Lee McEverley, if you remember, with me and Brabs. And he went to Rochdale. And people thought, he's a mad. He was top goal scorer with 12. I think we were in December or something, and Bees was second with 5, and people going, well, we're not really scoring loads of goals, and you're letting your top goal scorer go. And then we brought Scotty in. So I think Scott got 17 goals that season. So between them, 29 goals for the one forward. I combined the two of them as one. But he was great for us. He'd done different class. He came in, he slotted in straight away. Obviously, he knew quite a few of the players. But the way we played was different. And he was very good for us.
Yeah, classy player. Just wondered what your thoughts were on Scotty there. So cheers for that. Spoke to Danny Potter recently. He's going to be my next guest. And going back the other end of the pitch now. I've asked him to just say, what was Paul Carden like as a player and as a teammate, as a person and as a teammate rather? And I'll just read out what he said. He said, Cardy was a great guy. He was a professional on and off the pitch and a real leader. To be honest, his role in the team was probably undervalued because his organisation skills were exceptional and he always offered great protection for the guys at the back, other than when he thought that he was Messi going on one of his mazy runs forward.
That's kind of him. I thought he was going to, I thought I'd get a bit of stick off Potsy. Now we had a good relationship, me and Potsy. We weren't afraid to have a go at one another if we felt the need to. But as a keeper at the time, I don't think there was many better than him in the league. He had a wand of a left foot that, you know, with the players we had playing in, the likes of who we've said, Pitty and Chrissy Olroyd and Robbie Wilmot, and the pace that they had, it was an attacking weapon for us on the counter attack, and we used it a lot. You know, we used it from goal kicks playing out, where he'd reverse a ball to Gleiss from the left side, but he could drill a ball but he made some big saves for us as well. He made some big saves. He made a great save in that Stevenage game, big claw away. And I think that was from Robbo, actually. I think that was from Mark Roberts. Good lad. I think I seen he's playing a game. And he used to get a bit of stick. off the lads because he used to get called Shirley off EastEnders because he'd dye his hair and he was a bit of a he liked to be in the mirror putting a bit of product on. Not that I know what product is like, but so I'm told.
I was going to say,
I'm told. The old jelly used to put on and his highlights and all that, and you know his pink kit and his matching boots and too much for me. World cups and get on with it. That's what I was.
That's it. Black boots, hair shaved.
That's the one. But no, he was great for us, Potty. Good lad too.
Yeah, weren't he just? Yeah, but some good words and summed you up pretty well there, Potsy did. So fair play.
Yeah, I'll have to thank him for that.
Yeah,
I'll have to pay him. I'll have to pay him as well.
I thought you already had.
Yeah.
So we'll just sort of round it up then, Cardi. So I appreciate your time. Been fantastic value, and this will be great for Cambridge fans because, you know, I was talking to my missus earlier, and obviously it showed you a picture. You held my daughter back in the day. She was 18 months there, like the funky stick it up there for anyone that wants to see it. You know, I mean, you tend to think you're at Cambridge 3 or 4 years ago. You think, yeah, Cardi played. You work when you work it out, it's frightening.
No, it's horrible. Yeah, it's horrible.
It's madness.
I think I seen Robbie Wilmot was 30. He was playing on the telly for Newport in the cup. Yeah. And it said 30-year-old Robbie Wilmot, and I'm like, oh my god.
I feel
old now. And it's not even your kids that make you feel old, because our Will's 12, and when we moved to Cambridge he was a few months. So it's not even that. It's when you see players you've played with and they're retiring and you think, oh my god, or like I say with Robbie, he's 30. I'm thinking, he was 18 when I played with him. You know what I mean? I was 41 in March, and I'm like, oh my god. And when people ever ask me, like, you know, about playing or whatever it is, I always say, well, when I was alive, I played for Cambridge, Chester, Doncaster. Because honestly, it's, you know, when people say it, and I've heard old pros say it, and he said it when I was playing, you know, play till you can, because play till as long as you can. And I play for, believe it or not, I play on a Sunday with me dad and all his mates.
Really?
Called the Over the Hill Mob. We go to Germany every year. We go to Hartlepool. We go all over the place. We have a fixture every week. My dad's 62.
Wow.
And he's fit as, and he still plays. And I think the big thing with the lads, and a lot of the lads who I played with, especially at Cambridge, and that, if they weren't getting paid to play football, they'd pay subs to play.
Yes.
And that's what makes the difference in sides that are successful, is the lads, you know, that's just a bonus, the wages and doing it as a job. We're privileged to do that. But, you know, if they weren't doing that and they were working 9 to 5, they'd pay subs on a Wednesday night to play 5-a-side and play subs on a Saturday or a Sunday to play. And that's, you know, I'm still trying to get about the pitch, but I've got a bit of a Ned Kelly now and a bit of a fatter ass, so it's I'm not as mobile as I once was, but playing with me dad should really make me look a bit more mobile. But at 62, he's actually fitter than me, so I'm a bit ashamed of that.
Brilliant, that's great. I was going to ask you, you know, leaves a little bit of a hole when you stop playing the game that you love, and you think that's it. You think you're just going to keep playing, but it's good that you can still do that. And yeah, you're obviously a natural leader on the pitch, so to be managing was no surprise. And you know, I'd love to see you managing up even higher. I think you'd be great, even Cambridge United. You never know.
Well, stranger things happen, don't they? And I'd love that, but you know, I'm a big believer that you need to earn your stripes no matter what you do. And we've hit the bar a few times at Cambridge when I was there as a player, and at Warrington I've hit the bar a few times. So maybe need a different approach and see if we go one better next season, which will hopefully happen.
Yeah, fingers crossed for you. We'll just wrap it up then, Cardi. We've got a few tributes and questions from the Cambridge United fans of the Amber Army Facebook page, which has about 4,000 members. You were very popular once I put your picture up with Wayne Hatswell there and got about 30 likes in 24 hours. And got a few questions and tributes. I've got a really touching tribute actually from someone called Andy Sharrett. And he said, Carden was my third favourite player of all time behind Paul Wanless and Tom Finney.
Right.
Which is quite a good recognition.
Definitely. Definitely nice to hear when you put him with names. I know Wanny was obviously so highly regarded by the fans there, and a good lad as well. Nice to be mentioned around those types of players.
Yeah. Tom Cody says, what's Paul's favourite goal for Cambridge? I remember him scoring a screamer of a volley 30 yards out in the top corner of Rushton and Diamonds.
Yeah, I did. Probably that one. Probably that one. I remember Gleese sold me a short pass, and I had to I went in for a tackle with Jefferson Louis, and you know, he was always gonna pull out, wasn't he? Big whatever. And I was gonna call him a big Jesse then, but he probably filled me in now. Anyway, I rode the tackle, come through the tackle, and then I just let one go, and it went in the top bin. Yeah, so probably that one. But they won against Histon, the winner against Histon, where we won. Yeah, volley from the edge of the box. That was a nice one as well. So yeah. I didn't score too many for Cambridge, but I won two goal of the seasons. I've still got them in here somewhere. Probably over in that cabinet there. Two goal of the season. So I used to save them. I'd store them up. I used to wind Gleeson and Potty up actually by saying I don't like these goals from inside the box. I go for 30-yard tap-ins. A couple of good ones, but not enough, unfortunately.
There was one against Oxford as well. It's pretty special. Remember standing behind that.
I forgot about that one, and that's my little lad shows all his mates that one, because that's on YouTube. That's my dad scoring that. That was another one.
Jamie Cox says, what did you think of Martin Ling as a manager?
I think Ling had troubles at the time when he came to Cambridge. And although obviously it wasn't out there in the open, I think you could see he wasn't thinking like he should have been. You know, at times you'd see his commitments, and then other times you know he'd be not feeling right, so you know his mind would be elsewhere. And I think he's come out and he's it's been well publicised that about how he was at the time with what he was suffering with. And I think probably I didn't see the true manager, and I don't think any Cambridge fans seen the true manager of what Lingy was before that. Obviously his time at Leighton Orient, he was very successful and had a really good side. I still keep in contact with Lingy. Still message each other now and again, Christmases and whatever, and you know, obviously it's my birthday or his birthday on Facebook, you know. But he was a nice fella, Lingy, and you know, I'm glad he's on the mend anyway.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, nice words. I think, like I say, it's probably just bad. Well, it was just bad timing. I was excited when the appointment of Ling, you know, coming to Cambridge. He was a cracking player in his day, I remember.
Yeah, he was.
Coming to Cambridge with Swindon and Glenn Hoddle, and just thought he's a good football man and, you know, he'll steer us in the right direction. But sadly, you know, it's the wrong timing for him. And he's doing good things and seems in a happier place at Leighton Orient. So that's good to hear. Daniel Wood, so I know he's a bit of a Newmarket roadite, and he goes around with a few of the lads. I've heard him screaming your name a few times.
Good lad.
Cardi has had such passion and drive in his pomp, and was one of the finest box-to-box midfielders we've seen at the Abbey. He has my utmost respect, so please thank him for the passion and the warrior spirit he showed in the conference days. We haven't seen many players in the 30-odd years I've supported the club with his heart and bollocks.
Thanks very much, Dan. The nice words, Dan.
Yeah.
Very nice words. As I say, it is what you are. You play, you know, you play. I tried to play how I trained and give everything. And, you know, I wasn't as cultured as you like, see, Rob Wollaston's and things like that. And, but, you know, I always gave everything I had. And, you know, I say that to me lad, you know, you can't be questioned on that. And, you know, I tell him about fitness being free. It doesn't cost you anything to be as fit as you can. And that's what I always try to be, because I heard Roy Keane talking about being insulted about people saying he covered every blade of grass. And I have a pretty similar mindset. Well, what else? What else should you be doing? You know, you're there to do that job.
But that was recognised, and even as we said, it's years on, and people still hold high regard.
Yeah, nice words.
Again, we've had a few like that. Just say thanking you for your time, and really appreciative. We see players and managers come and go as part and parcel of football, but. You know, I read some of these and from yesterday, and you definitely left your mark on Cambridge United, Cardi, that's for sure. I mean, I say it, I know you're sort of on a personal level, and without sounding too sort of cheesy, you're definitely one of my favourite players. I absolutely loved watching you out there. You were battling, you were fighting for my team, you know, whether come what may, you were out there and you were giving everything. And, you know, that's what a supporter likes to see. And
yeah, you know, definitely.
You were a bloody good footballer as well. We'll just finish off with Graham Appleton then. I believe he sponsored you, Cardi.
Yeah.
Graham Appleton, yeah. He said, we have never replaced Paul's ball winning and leadership. He also says he's a great bloke. And, yeah, he was there. Yeah, he was a great bloke. Sorry, he wants to ask a question. Sorry about it, Cardi, but he said, great bloke. We never replaced his ball winning and leadership. And he also got a question. He said, did Gary Brabin ever lose his temper in the dressing room? That would have been a scary thought, as he was a beast of a man.
Yeah, funnily enough, we've met up a couple of times. Hats, Bolly, Bees. And we've met up and we speak, and When you meet up and speak with the lads, you know, that you haven't seen for a while, you'll talk over old stories that you've spoke about before, but last time you were out on the piss. And and we always speak about, we were playing Weymouth away, and we were 2-0 up. They had a man sent off and we drew 2-2. And Brabs came in after the game. And I used to say to him more, I said it to him at Luton, he should have done it more at Luton. He should have kicked off loads at Luton, because, you know, there were certain times it needed it. And he just wouldn't do it, because he's one of them. When he switches, he's hard to rein in. You know what I mean? And you wouldn't want him swinging. And he came in after the Weymouth game, and it was a crate of Red Bull, and he booted this crate of Red Bull, and it just went everywhere. It was like in a sealed like crate, and it cans, and he went everywhere, and he hit the wall, and he hit the ceiling, and he was square, and he'd split like loads of cans. And everyone sat there getting drenched with this Red Bull tracksuit, everything getting soaked. And no one moved. No one moved. We had Red Bull just pissing everywhere, all over us, dripping off us and everything. And he went mad. He went absolutely off his head. But funny story, I know we're gonna wrap it up, but a funny story.
Yeah, no worries, crack on, Cardi.
When we first went in to as management. We had a meeting with the players, and Potty had been on to Brabs already, just wanted to talk to him, and phoned him up, asked me for his number, and phoned him up, and he said, can I come in and meet you, blah blah blah. So we were at the club, and out of nowhere Reedy came in, Stephen Reed, and Brabs had obviously, he was managing Southport at the time in the Conference North, so Brabs had obviously seen us on the telly, and he hadn't watched us that often because Southport got in the Conference North playoffs that year. So fixtures clashed, and I spoke about the players, and we went through the players and the squad and what have you. And I said, and he knew Potsy was coming in, and he said, what do you think of Potsy? So I recommend, like said, yeah, definitely good enough. Miles, you know, I think he's better than the level. And he said, okay, then we'll have a good chat with him. But Reedy wasn't, we weren't expecting Reedy to come in. So Reedy walks in, bold as brass, how he is, funny fella, him, funny lad, yeah, him, good lad. So he walks in, and he goes, Cardi, is Brabs in? And I went, you don't know Brabs? It's like, say, is Brabs in? Like, you know, but that was, you know. So I said, yeah, he's in the office, just go and knock. And I thought nothing of it, and I've gone out to put the kettle on or something. And I've come in, and Reedy's in the corner, and he looks like he's shit himself. And Brabs has, like, looked at me, and he's gone, why didn't you tell me he was coming in? And I went, why? And he said, he's come in. And he went, I'll tell you in a minute. He went, come on, I'll see you Monday or something like that, to read you, or I'll see you whenever. See you on Thursday. So I'm thinking, what's going on here? It's only been a couple of minutes. So I followed Reedy out, and I went, what have you said there? What's happened there? And he went, he thought I was fucking Potsy.
Did he really?
He said, and I said to him, you know, where do you see me fitting in this season? Because, like, there's been clubs on and all that. And Brabs had said to him, well, you know, you're my number one, you're my first choice. Yeah. Because he'd only arranged, and I'd said Potsy wasn't the biggest, and he had blonde hair, bleached blonde hair, and he'd obviously seen Potsy, but on the telly, and not like realised, but only had one meeting arranged, and that was with Potsy. And Reedy walks in, where'd you see me fitting in? And he said, well, you're my number one keeper, you're here next season, blah, blah, blah. And he goes, I'm not a fucking keeper. I'm not a keeper. I'm a left back or a centre mid. And Brabs went, who are you? I don't know who you are. And Reedy went, yeah, he went, but Reedy hardly played under Quinny. He didn't play a lot. Yeah. And he said to Brabs, you don't know who I am. I'm Stephen Reed. And Brabs got up on the table and he went, don't you fucking come in here giving it all that. But we laugh so much about it, even now, like Reedy has a laugh, Brabs has a laugh about it, and we, you know, Potsy knows, but what a funny start to Reedy's meeting with Brabs, thinking he was the goalie. He probably could have been a good goalie, actually, Reedy, thinking about it. But funny days then.
It was good having that Northern link, you know, just to finish off. You know, I was thinking about it earlier. You know, you had like yourself, then Brabs. We're almost proud to have it like that. Bees, Bolland, and then Andy Parkinson, who even to this day gutted we didn't, you know, he'd have been, what a signing for us he'd have been. But obviously, Everton smashed him in pre-season and looked at the real deal and thought, we've got a player here, and then obviously got the injury. But that Northern connection, even you said about Lee McEverley, what a character. Fans loved him. That song now, I think I still sing it around the house sometimes. Lee McEverley, the Cambridge number nine. I loved it. And the Burton playoffs. But, yeah, what a, you know, credit to all you boys, because every one of you came and played your part, all you Northern lads.
Yeah. And, good brilliant. Times, mate. It was good times. As I say, it was just a pity we couldn't... Get out the conference and get into the league. But we had a go, and, you know, just glad to see the club. You know, it's had a wobble, you know, last however long, but, you know, had some good times being up, being in the league, and obviously Dickie Dosh sorted things out and got, you know, got things going. But I'm pleased to see the club in the league, because it was we put a lot of work in to try and get there, and it never happened. And, you know, just glad to see that it's doing well, and, you know, the fans are smiling, you know, probably want to smile more. But, you know, it's football, and it's good to see that there's a lot of people there and a lot of names still stiffing by being proper supporters. So nice to know.
Yeah, certainly. Have you got any just final message for the supporters that still reminisce, you know, think massively highly of you. As I've said there, just reading some of their messages out, you're up there with, you know, the likes of Tom Finney and Paul Wanless and some of the supporters that have supported the club for so long. So it must be pleasing for you to look back and think, I did all right there.
Yeah, it is. It's really nice to be thought of and still be remembered, really. You know, because time moves quickly, and like you said before, players come and go in all football clubs. And you know, you're wearing one colour shirt one day, and then you're wearing another one for another club the next day, and the players and the fans, sorry, you know, go on to the next favourite player. So to be remembered and to hear the words that, you know, some of the fans have spoke of me is really nice. And you know, I hope one day to come back and see everybody, and you know, maybe it might be in a management football role, maybe it might just be as a fan and have a pint after the game, no matter what, anyway, with a few people who still speak to now and again.
Brilliant, yeah. Great words, Cardi. So thank you so much for your time. It's been like, yeah, fantastic to catch up with you. Some funny and great stories and bits we didn't know from behind the scenes. And and thank you for serving Cambridge United so well. And as someone echoed there, we still haven't really replaced you. So what a player. And thanks.
Well, I'm gonna go training then and see whether I can nick a deal. 41, you know. I might change the deal. So, but no, thanks for having me anyway, and good luck with everything.
Cheers, Cardi. Thank you so much, mate, and take care. Good luck with Warrington.
Cheers, mate. Catch you later.
Cheers. All the best.